Yes, sir. Yes, madam. This bag doesn't contain some overworked embroidery or mending, or even a cabbage. But the head of my late husband, Sir Walter Ralegh, separated from his body in the year 1618.
Take all of this fabric, Sidney. Cover their chief with gold dust, so that he becomes El Dorado, the gilded one. The people heap emeralds, other jewels, gold objects around him, and they set him on a raft upon the lake. He throws the treasure into the water to petition the gods for peace and harmony within the tribe. The gold and jewels sink to the bottom of the lake. I don't know what becomes of the man. Perhaps he becomes a god, or sacrificed.
It was said of him, he hath been a star at which the world hath gazed, and like a star must fall. They could not catch him, could not be there to comfort him, could not cradle his dear head, until now.
Finally you find your way to our court. We have heard fascinating reports.
I won't flatter myself that they have all been favorable, Your Majesty.
I use my own scales to measure a man's value. You know, I knew your aunt, Kat Astley.
Our family was honored by her appointment.
She was a second mother to me. She set me on a path to learning. Look at the stars, my lady. Can you name them? She taught me the map of the heavens, as well as un peu de français, puis d'un latine, hellenica, and a great gob of Flemish. A very kind and learned lady. Did you know her well?
Her duties left her little time for visits home, but I knew her a little. And her sister, my mother, was also educated to a very great degree for a woman.
Even mares can be taught to count, you know, using their hooves.
Oh, I did not mean to offend, madam.
I tease. You'll get used to it. But consider, we have both been brought up by sisters. That almost makes us family. Cousin what? Come closer. At 15, you fought in France. So young. And we have noted your campaigns in Ireland against the rebels and their allies.
I wanted to prove my worth to you.
And you are from Devon? More a merman than a gentleman.
I do love the sea. I think I've been affected by the same sickness as many of my relatives.
But not seasickness, Ralegh, otherwise you contradict yourself.
No. I meant the sickness. That love of the sea that infects so many of my relatives. Frobisher, Hawkins, Drake.
We are unlikely to be impressed with name dropping.
Forgive me.
Your Majesty ceases to be a benefactor.
Hard to distinguish between my toes and the floor. Happy to dance on either.
else have you heard? Come on, every man here has been thoroughly dissected by the Queen's lips.
I hear that you're only interested in gold and advancement, that you're arrogant.
All true. But what else?
That you are fearless in battle.
And in love, baby.
You smashed the siege at the fort in Ireland, where the Spanish soldiers were holed up with their Irish allies, planning for Catholic invasion.
I would lay down my life to protect my queen and my England.
You apparently laid down the lives of some 600 souls.
Some here might say that Catholics don't have souls.
Women and children, too. Pregnant women. The slaughter against the unarmed was fearless.
Government. We may have fallen out before, we have fallen in.
I simply want to know as much about you as I can before I fall in.
Might I be allowed to...
To what, Sir Walter?
To kiss.
Sir.
Oh, I'm too full. I take a step back and now I'm spoiling the dance because I can't touch you.
Come nearer, people are staring.
Kiss.
We are touching hands, Sir Walter. Palm to palm is the only palm's kiss.
Ah, a line straight from the playhouse.
I think plays express what we can.
Poets too can claim that.
I've never met a poet yet that I like. They always make women into goddesses and then loathe them for being human. When I laugh, she mocks. When I cry, she laughs and hardens evermore her heart. What then can move her? Mirth nor moan. She is no woman, but a senseless stone. You see? If we refuse to love a man simply because he demands it, we are senseless stones, statues. Mm.
I will write you poetry that will make you flesh and blood, Bess. Her face, her tongue, her wit. So fair, so sweet, so sharp. First bent, then drew, now hit my eye, my ear. My heart.
Come here, child.
Your Majesty.
We have the most efficient, most devious spy network in Europe. Yet we often have to learn the most useful information from gossip. Like the lowest of our kitchen servants.
Madam?
Do you like stories, Bess? We remember your father was so keen on stories that he couldn't wait to hear new ones, but had to make up his own tales. Tales that he was foolish enough to put in writing.
My father,
he counseled us when we were your age against marriage with Lord Dudley. And repeated the slanderous gossip of the French court so thoroughly it became known here. And what was that poisonous gossip?
I'd rather not give any.
Say it.
It was said Lord Dudley had murdered his wife so he would be free to marry me.
And that slander meant that the ordinary domestic pleasures of close comfort and love were denied me. And now a fresh story about a pregnancy and a marriage made in secret. I have to wonder where the gossip stops and the facts begin. No one will confirm or deny a rumor. They hide when they cease. They struggle light from their eyes, this rumour, this story that directly affects us.
Rumour, Your Majesty?
Why has this been kept from me? I should be the first to know. We would like to believe that all our subjects have our best interests at heart. What do you think, Bess?
Your Majesty deserves the love and loyalty of all her subjects.
Deserves? I am owed for what I have sacrificed and continue to sacrifice. devoted to the care of our kingdom and its subjects.
Of course.
And loyalty is really just another word for fidelity. What did you say? What did you do to our captain of the guard, our pug, to take him from us?
Do, madam.
Do not look at me, girl! Do you want me to beat you? I once broke a woman's finger, I beat her so hard. Some time ago. Is this true? Is this true?
It is. He knew it would cause you displeasure and pain.
Pain? Do you speak to us of pain? We have been imprisoned. We have been threatened by plots and assassins and tricked by men like your father into executing, murdering our own cousin, another God-appointed queen. And we wake every day with that pressing heart here. And now you and he mock our barren state with that. We're going to walk in our garden. The sun is shining, I think.
What do you plan for us, Your Majesty?
Though now we look at the sky, there are some clouds on the horizon. We should hurry if we are to walk before the rain starts.
Madam!
We are sending you and your new husband to the tower. Dampen your honeymoon ardor.
Rancid with anxiety. Courtiers are abandoning her and making overtures to James of Scotland.
Write to him. Offer your service.
No. Yes. The Queen stands like a child, gazing at nothing, saying nothing.
Makes a change.
She won't sleep. She's frightened that death will find her in her bed.
We'll find her in her bed or out of it.
And she will leave. Thank you.
now he prepares for his last great voyage. The one we must all take, either we want to or not. What are you writing? Give me my scallop shell of quiet, my staff of faith to walk upon, my script of joy, immortal diet, my bottle of salvation, my gown of glory, hope's true gauge, and thus I'll take my pilgrimage.
I think I'll wear two shirts. It is October, and I can't be seen to shiver. For a long time, my course has been a course of vanity. I've been a seafaring man, a soldier, and a courtier. And in the least of these, there are enough temptations to overthrow a good mind and a good man. And so I take my leave of you all, making my peace with God. I have a long journey to make. And so I must bid the company farewell. And then I shall examine the axe. Let me see. I think I am afraid of it. It is a sharp medicine, but it is a physician for all diseases.
You refuse the blindfold.
Do you think I fear the shadow of the axe when I fear not the axe itself?
You approach the block, your body facing west, not east.
West of the New World, to honor my lost colony and my lost son. What is our life? It is a play of passion. What is our mirth? The music of division. Our mothers, they the tiring houses be, where we are dressed for time's short tragedy. Earth is the stage, heaven's the spectator is. Who doth behold, who e'er doth act amiss? Graves, which hide us from the parching sun, are but drawn curtains till the play be done. When I stretch out my hand, dispatch me.